Greetings, good evening, and welcome to tonight's talk in the Yale Institute of Sacred Music series, Lectures in Art, Faith, and Social Justice. I'm Evan Graves from the ISM, and it's a real pleasure to welcome you for tonight's talk with Reverend Stephen Blackmer, titled Original Beauty, Nature as the First Source of Beauty and Divine Inspiration. Before I introduce our speaker in a bit more detail, I just wanted to point out at the bottom of your webinar screen there, you're gonna see a Q&A button. And after the lecture tonight, we're going to have time for some questions, so you can feel free to put your questions in there during the lecture or afterwards, and we'll try to get to as many of your questions as possible following tonight's talk. Just a bit more about the speaker, Reverend Stephen Blackmer is a priest at Church of the Woods in Canterbury, New Hampshire. He created Church of the Woods in 2014 to restore Christian practice and understanding of Earth herself as a bearer of sacred presence. Prior to being ordained in the Episcopal Church in 2013, Stephen worked for 25 years to conserve and restore forests, rivers, and rural communities in northern New England and New York. He has a bachelor's degree from Dartmouth College, a master's degree in forest ecology from Yale School of the Environment, and a master's in religion and environment from Yale Divinity School. So it's a real pleasure to welcome him back here to Yale, and I'm sure people will be giving you a warm welcome from all around cyberspace here. So welcome.
Thank you, Evan. And hello, everybody. I'm delighted to be able to be here with you. I'm going to obviously talk about Church of the Woods, my community in New Hampshire. What I want to do is begin with just a little bit of a brief, a further introduction, building on what Evan said, describe a little bit what I'll talk about, and then go into an opening meditation, as we do every Sunday when we open services at Church of the Woods. So as Evan said briefly, I began my professional work with a degree in forest ecology, and that took me to all kinds of wonderful conservation work, protecting lands and rivers and mountains primarily around northern New England. And then 15 years ago now, I began to feel increasingly an urge to find another way to influence the human relationship with the natural world. I hardly have to tell anybody who's paying attention on this in this conversation that the way human beings have related with the earth in the last hundreds of years has been devastating to the land itself, that is the productive forests and cropland and desert, to the creatures that live there, and increasingly to the people on the margins, the people who are less fortunate. And after 25 years of doing wonderful work, quite successfully, I said, there's got to be another way to do this. There's got to be something deeper. We're putting Band-Aids on these problems, and we're not getting at the root of what this is about. So long story short, that led me to leave that so-called secular work to come back to Yale at the Divinity School. And knowing that my call to be a priest was somehow about the earth, about conservation, about continuing that, but in a different fashion. And it wasn't until after I graduated that I heard a little whisper one day in the woods that said, start a church. I said, oh, a church? You mean like a woods church? I could do a woods church. What's a woods church? So that was 2012, and began the journey that I'm still on of discovering what it is that a woods church is, how it, at least as I've been given it, what we do, and what it means. So I'm gonna talk in seven parts, this being the first. And if you want to look at that and overlay onto that, the 7 days of creation at the beginning, you may. But we're going to begin with, as we always do, with a silent meditation for several minutes. When we're at Church of the Woods in person, we're obviously able to stand there enveloped by the space with all of our senses open. So I'm going to invite you to open your senses in your imagination. Imagine that you're standing in the woods in a circle with other people, but that the group you're with is not limited to human beings. And through the visuals that Eben will put up on the screen, we'll just imagine ourselves in the presence of this enormous number of creatures and beings, all of whom are gathered together. So Eben, if you would please take us to the slides.
Okay, will do.
Thank you. Amen. So inviting us back from our meditation, the first thing, of course, one might notice looking at this as a church is where it is. When I was at Yale, one of the many things I absorbed was the lesson that liturgically, the space always wins. That is, whatever one might be trying to do liturgically has to fit first into the space that that one is in. So the most fundamental thing about Church of the Woods is simply to notice where it takes place and what that says about the practice of the sacred practice of gathering a community of faith. It takes place in the woods, in a setting that is not shaped by human beings. Unlike every building, buildings can be inspired, they can be beautiful, they can certainly be ugly, they can function well or not well, but they're all created by human beings. And buildings as sacred spaces, therefore, means that our relationship with the divine, with God, is necessarily mediated through human constructions, through human artifacts. And the first thing that Church of the Woods does is remove some of that mediating influence and put us directly in touch with the creation that we do not make, that precedes us, that indeed, in the biblical language, is the very first thing that comes into being. It begins with the creation. So we're surrounded by it in that place, opening up, therefore, what it means for us to be in relationship with not only with the natural world, but with the divine source from which it all springs. So that's the first thing, is where this takes place. I will say, by way of note, that we do have two little buildings. We did not at the beginning. We have a little barn where we gather sometimes in the weather, and now, as of about a year ago, a little chapel also, that both can be heated and keep us dry, because in many climates, but certainly in New Hampshire, having an indoor space is enormously helpful on a day like today. The rain that we're having now is about to turn to snow, so we're grateful for indoor spaces. But the meeting space remains outdoors. So the where, the next component of that is who is gathered in any gathering space. Of course, who is present also shapes a great deal of the experience. At Church of the Woods, the human beings are vastly outnumbered by the non-human beings. And yet we are all members of one community, of one congregation. And this reinforces the sense that we all come from the same source, we all return from the same source, and that in fact, we're all kin in one way and another. The first and the greatest commandment from the Hebrew Bible, and then repeated, of course, by Jesus, is, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and mind and soul and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourselves." On this, he continues in Matthew's gospel in particular, on this hangs all the law and prophets. So it's that call to love our neighbor that Church of the Woods opens for us in a different kind of way, that our neighbor are not merely those people who happen to live in the house next door, but are, and not only other human beings, but our neighbors indeed are all the rest of creation. And this call to love is what's at the core of this. And the idea, as Jesus said in the Law and the Prophets, that all the calls for justice, for social justice, for ecological justice, for environmental justice, are derived from that initial call to love. Without love, we cannot work for justice. So we begin with that. And seeking to understand what that means and ourselves to be transformed by God's love as made present in the natural world, in the woods, and through all of these other creatures. These creatures that themselves are formed not for us, but simply to be, to express the glory of God, to revel in their own beingness. So that's the community as it forms. The what? So we began with the where, the space, the who, the community. The what? We follow a liturgy that I'm ordained in the Episcopal Church. So it begins with a liturgy in the pattern of the Episcopal Church, which is also essentially the pattern of the Roman Catholic Church, of the Lutheran Church, of the other liturgical churches in our tradition. So we begin with gathering, with an opening prayer. We read from scripture. I give a little homily. I'm going to come back to that for a minute. We have prayers and confession, and we end up with communion, with the Holy Eucharist. The pattern is a very familiar one, but the way we interpret it is a bit different. I want to talk about three parts of that in particular. On the face of it, the homily that I give is very brief, usually 2 or 3 or 5 minutes on a long day. But in fact, the sermon as a whole becomes a long one. After my brief homily, I invite people to go into the woods for a 20 minutes of silent meditation in the woods. We fan out, cautioning people not to go too far because we don't want anybody to get lost, even though it has happened, but never for very long. And I invite people to reflect on simply being present in the woods, on the scripture, on whatever else might be going on in the world or in their own hearts, and to keep an eye open for a treasure or a token to bring back. But let me stay on the silence for a moment. When I was again at Yale and was reading the Bible for the first time, it struck me one day as I was reading, it happened to be in Matthew's gospel, but it's in all of them, that Jesus goes alone up the mountain to pray. It's from the 14th chapter of Matthew. Whenever Jesus is portrayed in prayer, he is portrayed as being outdoors, usually in the evening or night or the very early morning. That is when other people aren't around, when it's silent and still, and he's alone. And he's off in the wilderness, in the desert, by the lake, at the ocean, in a lonely place. It was very clear from the Gospels that this is how Jesus' own prayer life is rooted. He's clearly deeply learned in the Hebrew scriptures. He quotes them often and particularly calls upon the Psalms. So he knows them well. He's been taught well, but his direct relationship with God, with his Abba, takes place in the wild places, outdoors. Why didn't anybody teach us this? Why didn't this ever get noticed? What is it that has prevented us from recognizing this, from following Jesus in this own pattern, his own pattern, and replicating it? If we claim that we're followers of Jesus, why haven't we seen this? So what we try and do is build that into the service so that we do see it, we recognize it, and even in a very brief period of time for 20 minutes, we follow that practice. And of course, I encourage people to do that more widely on their own anytime, and people do. But it's trying to both to learn what Jesus was learning, to be opened in our own bodies and spirits to God's presence in the natural world in silence, and also simply to follow, to be faithful disciples means learning from what he was teaching and what he was showing. So we spend that 20 minutes in silence. As I said, I invite people to bring back a token or a treasure. And when we do that, you may have seen this and noticed this in some of the slides, we place those on and around the altar as part of our offering to God. In fact, that becomes the core of our offering. We are giving back to God what we have received. In more traditional churches, that's done with money, and that's helpful too. And we all, of course, always need money, like any other church does. But what we're first giving back is these things that we have received in the form of these elements of the natural world. So they can be leaves, they can be mushrooms, they can be rocks, they can be flowers, they can be broken sticks, and there occasionally can be trash. It's not a lot of trash in these woods, but when somebody finds it, we bring that back and offer those broken things. But it's a sign of the respect, the reverence indeed, that we have for these pieces, these bits of the natural world, that we would offer them back to God and say, here, this is, we have nothing that's our own. Everything we've received, including the woods here, has been given to us. And all we can do is offer that back. And then we continue at the conclusion of the service with the Eucharist, with the Holy Communion. The liturgy of that is, which is available on our website, www.kairosearth.org. The liturgy talks about how we offer ourselves back also as part of our own holy sacrifice, which is again the thing we ultimately have to give back to God. But it also talks a great deal about our kinship with these elements of the natural world, emphasizing that relationship of love between us and the earth that bears us, the earth that holds us, that we are in fact neighbors and kin. And evolutionary science, of course, teaches a particular ways in which we may be kin, and the family trees and so on, and how we have evolved from other forms of life. But the key point is that we're all kin because we all come from the one source. And to live into a relationship, that kind of relationship of kindred. Families, as we know, don't always live in utter peace and harmony, and nor do we, but it provides a foundation. And then, of course, as in all services of communion, we conclude with consecrating and consuming the bread and the wine. And what's particularly distinctive here is that we begin with the first piece of bread that's consecrated is offered back to the earth herself. So it's given as an offering. And here, this consecrated bread, this body of Christ, is given back to you, back to the world, back to the earth from which all living things have sprung, reflecting that nowhere else in the universe still, so far as we know, is there life. Perhaps we will find it, and that will be a cause for amazement and joy. But in the meantime, all life ever that's been in existence in this universe is, so far as we know, held on this one planet, this one little earth. So we offer back this little bit, saying this love that Jesus represents is intended for all creation, for all the earth, and not only for us. And so both a sign of reverence for the earth and a sign of our reflecting that this is intended for all creation. And likewise, the last sip of wine is poured out for the whole world. So that's this establishing this direct relationship in the liturgy between the actual earth and the divine source that all comes from and to which all returns. So in this liturgy, we're living out, enacting a series of ways in relationships that people have in prayer with us, people have in prayer with the natural world, with the earth, with all creation. And yet it still holds a form that is quite traditional, even orthodox in its pattern. And yet interprets it for this particular time in the world. And so that's where I want to go to next. We've talked about where, about who, about what, and now this question of why. So what? Why does this matter? The key point to this is that it's no longer sufficient, in my view, for us to live on this earth as though the earth herself is just stuff, is just matter. The whole incarnational view of the world that's really at the center of Christian faith tells us, as in the Gospel of John, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That flesh, as I interpret it, as I understand it in a very Franciscan way of viewing things, is not only Jesus, not only Jesus, but the entire Christ, the entire creation that flows through the Christ, that all of this is imbued with divine being, with divine inspiration. And that if we actually believe this is true, if this theology is actually true, then it calls us to utterly transform our relationship with the whole earth, and indeed with ourselves. It opens us to a transformation within ourselves, that we can't help but being transformed as we're living in the presence of the entire world around us being filled with the sacred. Having worked all my life in one way and another on so-called environmental issues, I'm not particularly optimistic that we can solve the dilemmas that we're facing. I don't want to pretend that I'm optimistic. We, in our the growing extent of our knowledge and our power, have managed to create such extraordinarily large challenges, climate change being the most visible and certainly one in global in scale, that is already creating enormous effects and will continue to do so. So I find it hard to be optimistic, but I don't find it hard to be hopeful. And that's an important distinction here. The entire Christian story, and here we are in particular, soon after Easter, is one rooted in death and resurrection. At this time of year, it's so easy to look outside and see signs of resurrection all over the place as the earth springs back to life. And we teach and we believe that the Christ coming anew, born again out of the tomb, which is out of the womb, which is out of the earth, Jesus comes back as the Christ and the whole creation is restored. And we celebrate and reenact this every year and every week, indeed, is what a Sunday service is about. In doing so, in this, we have to also recognize the death that exists. Easter doesn't come without Good Friday. In a grand sense, right now, I feel as though we are living into an extended time of Good Friday, when we're going to be seeing death in things that, in the world around us, in ways of enormous grief, and learning how to live with that grief and to hold hope in the midst of that grief is, I think, going to be of immense importance. If we find out that the problems we've created are too big for us to fix, what do we do then? We're not going to restore things to the way they were. That's clearly the case. And new life doesn't come into being without the old passing away. And what this little tiny faith and practice offers, I think, is a way of living into that hope, even as we see things, even as we see a very, very hard times ahead. I'm Of course, there are so many things of kind of the practical things that we need to continue to be able to do. The infinite number of practices and advocacy actions and changes in consumptions, but there needs also to be a deeper transformation in us, in our human selves, in our relationship with God and with the creation, where we ourselves can become bearers of this sacred hope in the world. And it's my hope that that this little piece of what we're doing here is a way of opening us up to that. So there, I'm going to pause now and open this up for questions and see what happens. And we'll go from there. So Evan, let me turn to you for that.
Yes, thank you so much for this wonderful talk. I'm sure people are interested in posing some questions here. So just as a reminder, if you click on the Q&A button there at the bottom of the screen, you can send some questions over here for Reverend Blackmer. So I'm sure people are absorbing everything you said. I just have one question to, it's very broad. I hope it's not too broad, but to launch it. And I was wondering kind of your previous experience working in forest conservation and environmental protection, kind of as you, I think you said, you defined it more in a secular way. You know, what were some of the interrelationships between that previous experience and then starting Church of the Woods, you know, from either side, whether your previous experience, how it affected how you thought about the Church of the Woods or kind of vice versa?
I had no sort of religious or faith background until this all came along. So in that sense, there was no carryover. What there was a real love of the land, that a deep relationship. And for years, I'd say, why should I go to church when I can be outdoors on a beautiful Sunday? And that worked. That was sufficient for me for a long time. But then, since then it wasn't enough anymore. And I was looking for something deeper than that. But the knowledge that I gained, the love of all these creatures that I gained, certainly retained, certainly continued on.
Fascinating. Thanks. I hope the Q&A function's working there. Oh wait, I think we have one. Okay, here's a question coming through. Do you share in your services some of the new writings on plant and animal sensibilities?
Yeah, we do. It comes up fairly often. I think just because we see more plants than animals, that it comes up there, but trees, I mean, in particular with trees communicating with one another, those kinds of things come up either fairly often. And it's also palpable. We can simply just feel it, which is sort of we can learn about it, but we also just absorb it through our own beings, through our own bodies.
Great, thanks for that. Thanks for the question. Feel free to send any other questions over as well at this time. In terms of the little kind of opening meditation we did, I was a little bit slow clicking through it. I think it went a little bit over the 2.5 minutes, but what would a typical, would that be the similar duration that
you'd actually? Yeah, something like that. Yeah. So it's just a chance to get people there and be grounded in the space. And there's something very powerful about entering into silence in that kind of location together. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Another question coming through here from Steve Barrett. I moved to Chicago from Texas for retirement. Do you have any suggestions on how to live in the big city? the ads here, of course, Lake Michigan is near, but
I don't know. So move to Chicago.
Yeah,
there's an extensive network of parks and reserves around Chicago. Is there something? There may be something called Chicago Wild. I can't remember what it's called. Anyway, my friends who live in Chicago tell me that there's really a remarkable network of open spaces. So I don't have any firsthand experience, but that's what I would check out, and certainly Lake Michigan. But I think forests and prairie, wetlands, streams.
Can you imagine yourself living in a large city like Chicago or New York? Or?
I have.
Sorry, it's very personal.
Oh no, that's all right.
So much of your work is around being in nature.
One of the reasons I liked Yale was because New Haven has East Rock Park, which is where I would go every day. I certainly have lived in big cities, and they're so cool, and yet it's not really where I'm most at home. I could, but I probably wouldn't want to stay awfully long.
Okay, well, some questions are coming through here now. So from Marianne Hardy, what was the turning point for you, if there was a single event, that led to you developing a deeper faith-based relationship with the natural world?
Boy, that's a great question. I'm just trying to think back. It happened in steps. So I don't think I can say there was a single turning point. I think it happened over a series of steps over a number of years, mostly having to do with direct experience, immersions in the natural world in one way or another. There was one, if there was a single turning point, it was the time, this was actually on an airplane, so not in the natural world, when a voice said, "Priest, you're to be a priest." And, oh, okay. I'm making it sound like a small thing, but it wasn't. But that was sort of what began me saying, oh boy, there's a whole different dimension of this that that I haven't yet explored. And leading to that. But it's a continuing. It's just a continuing, ongoing opening and learning.
Wonderful, thank you. Here's another question from an anonymous attendee. What is one of your favorite ways that Church of the Woods serves its community?
Oh, the forming a community grounded in love. I think without question, and that's sort of the love among the human beings, but also the heartfelt relationships that form with this with that place, with the creatures there. It changes us from the inside. I think without a doubt, that's the most important thing.
Okay, here's an interesting question from one of our attendees. I'm not Christian, but my impression has always been that the Bible states or implies that the earth and everything on it are here for humans to use as they want or need. So if that is true, how do you reconcile this with the idea that we are all part of creation and we should be more mindful of our use of resources?
That's a great question. The Christian tradition has often been interpreted that way, although it's actually the key parts of the Bible from that are pre-Christian. They're in the early parts of the Hebrew Bible. There may be people here, and there are certainly others who are more knowledgeable about the scriptures than I am. But I think the way those are properly understood is that we're put here to, on behalf of God, to be the keeper and tender of the world, the stewards in that sense, who care for it and love it in in God's stead. It raises all kinds of interesting questions. Let me just talk about food for a minute. We have to eat in order to live, which means we have to take life in order to live. There's no other way for a human body to exist than to take the lives of other creatures. We can't eat rocks. We can only eat living. I mean, really, we can only eat living things or things that were living. So the question is not whether we do that, but how we do it. And to understand that as what we're doing is eating other creatures as an act of reverence for the fact that they exist, and that in some sense they have been they are giving their lives that we may live. Then in turn, what that invites us to do is give our lives in service of others, to pass that on. And we can mean that, I mean, I don't mean that literally we should be feeding each other to the lions, but that we offer ourselves in service, and that it's the only way we can repay, or in a better way to think about it is not repay, but to pay forward, to pay along that gift we've been given of having taken so many other creatures into our own bodies. We offer our body and ourselves in service to others. And there, what we're doing is putting ourselves in the right place of that, where we are simply one of many creatures who are doing this, because we're human beings. We have particular skills, gifts, and therefore challenges that other creatures don't have. But unless we offer ourselves in service onward, then we live in effect as though it's all just for us. And that's, I think, a deeply wrong view of Christian faith, but of any deeply ethical way of living on the earth.
Great, thanks. Here's another question. I wonder if you have thoughts about Indigenous thinking and practices in relationship to being on the land and our connection to it, physically and spiritually.
Another great question. I don't know enough to be able to speak with any particular knowledge. It's not my tradition. It's not my background. It's not an area of learning or practice for me. So I think I'm going to, answer the question in a little bit different way, and saying, I honor those, and I'm grateful that there are people who are in those traditions who know how to live in right relationship with the land and its creatures. What I'm trying to do with Church of the Woods is learn how to do that from within my tradition, which is a Western European Christian tradition. That's my ancestry. And to create, recreate, because they've been there, recreate ways of living in harmony with the land and with all the earth that are from my tradition, my ancestry, my people, and say, that's the piece of the work that I think I can do. And I'll have to defer to others on answering things about Indigenous traditions.
Great, thanks. I mean, there's a lot of questions here. Hopefully we can get to most of them.
I'll keep going until you or others tell us it's time to stop. Okay.
I mean, there's kind of a cluster that seem to be people interested about what kind of resources are available to other congregations interested in having more of an environmental focus. So one here, sure. What resources might you suggest congregations use if they wanted to expand their use of environmental liturgy?
Two questions or three questions quickly. I'll probably think of more come to mind. Many denominations have that are through their own denominations have resources. So depending on what denomination one is in, certainly the Episcopal Church and Lutheran and Presbyterian and Methodist Catholic and, you know, many. So that's a good place to look. Since this is being hosted by Yale, the Yale Forum on Religion and Ecology is a great resource. So the Yale Forum on Religion and Ecology and all kinds of stuff. There's a relatively new movement that I helped get started called the Wild Church Network. So wildchurchnetwork.org is a reservoir of information for people who are starting on doing this kind of stuff. Let's see, the national group used to be affiliated with the National Council of Churches. I think it's called Creation Justice Ministries, but I'm not sure that I've got that right. Again, a wealth of knowledge, a lot of that having to do with national advocacy stuff. So there's really a great deal of stuff around now. The amount of information that's available has just expanded, I mean, huge numbers over the last 10 or 15 years. I'd poke around online. There's a ton of stuff, but Forum on Religion and Ecology is a great place to begin.
I didn't have all the references handy, but Yale Forum on Religion Ecology, of course, we have a lot of connections with them at the ISM. I just popped the link in for their website here for John Griffin, Mary Evelyn Tucker.
Yeah, I mean, they in a lot of ways, they were at the forefront of creating this kind of way of thinking as a movement, and were a big part of why I went to Yale.
Great. Here's an interesting piece of history and questions from Tim Weskel. I hope I'm pronouncing the name right. I remember growing up in New Hampshire, where I lived in Amherst. I was later a Rhodes Scholar from New Hampshire, graduating from Yale over 50 years ago. At the time I grew up in New Hampshire, there was a place called the Cathedral of the Pines.
Mm-hmm.
And does that relate to what you're doing in Church of the Woods?
Yeah, Cathedral of the Pines still exists. I don't know that it's got the particular certainly not the liturgical or the same purpose that we do, but it's an extraordinarily beautiful place. Sort of just the idea that nature is itself inherently a cathedral, or that is inherently a sacred space, it's been doing for a long time. So yeah, it's still there.
Is that a kind of a built space, or is it more of a preserved space? And
they have, I've been there on the land. I haven't been in the build. They have both. Uh-huh. But it's, and I think it's available for use, people do weddings there and things like that. But I'm afraid I don't actually know about the buildings any longer.
Got it. So here's a question from a listener in Connecticut. Is there a place in Connecticut that you know of where there's a similar kind of connection between church and the divine situated in the woods, maybe for something more locally?
There's no actual sort of church or worshiping community that I'm aware of, although if you look at the Wild Church Network website, that would tell you. There are certainly retreat centers, quite a number of them.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay, here's an interesting one. I hear from an anonymous attendee, I hear the use of feminine pronouns in describing the earth body. How do you reconcile the largely male or masculine centered perspective of scripture with your sense of the feminine as a life giver? Mm. The readings of scripture as male, masculine centered to begin with.
Another really great question. Thanks. Scripture were both Hebrew and Christian texts were written in very patriarchal cultures. So starts from that, and with Hebrew in particular, some of the original writing was in a as I understand it, there are many people who know much more about this than I, but non-gendered language that as it found its way into a gendered language was expressed in the masculine. In our use of the Psalms in particular, we use a version of the Psalms where an effort has been made to remove gendered language for exactly those reasons. I'm trying to think about how deep to go into this one. We talk a lot about, as the questioner noted, about the earth and relationship or the overlaying between the earth and, in the Christian tradition, Mary or the Marys as the feminine or representing the feminine part of this story. And none of the creation happens without, or the spirit doesn't descend without a place to descend into. So there's whole ways of expressing this that reflect both the masculine and feminine dimensions of this. In a sense, it's one of the other things that that a Church of the Woods does by comparison, for example, with a Gothic cathedral, which is this intense, very masculine form of architecture, where Church of the Woods is a much flatter, gentler, earthier, one can say, I want to be a little careful with this, but a more feminine form of structure than any tall spire, especially an enormous cathedral reaching towards the sky. So inherently, again, back to the space itself, it's a very different kind of feel. Also the way we gather, we tend to gather in a circle. So just kind of trying to eliminate some of the senses of hierarchy, which are not necessarily gender, but of hierarchy, and flattening out and grounding everything that we're doing. So there's just a beginning of an answer to could talk forever about a number of these things.
Yeah, that's a big topic. Thank you. And just, you mentioned about a group coming together. There's a question here about, someone who's curious about the average age in your church. Are your services maybe attracting more younger age demographic or what have you there?
Yeah, another great question. Like many churches, the preponderance of the people who come are older, people who've got a lifelong practice to the earth, practice of going to church rather. What has been interesting, and I want to thank Yale and faculty and students at Yale in particular for this, is we've had a lot of students, a lot of people who are thinking about going to or just out of seminary in particular, many of them, most of them from Yale, most of them connected with Yale. Relatively few of them, in fact, currently none of them actually live close, so it's harder for them to come on an every week basis. But some of you perhaps listening are included in this group. So we've actually got two, if you kind of map it demographically, two populations that are the most common. One is late 20s, early 30s, people who have a particular vocational interest in this generally, and people 60s and 70s. Yeah. It's been interesting. I've got a few young families, and as soon as young families with kids figure out how much fun it is for kids, there'll be more of those.
How far a drive is it from kind of New Haven up to?
It's 3 to 3.5 hours, depending on the traffic. So it's not short. Yeah. It takes some effort.
Yeah, definitely. And there's a question here about how your church is connected to a larger network of like-minded communities. And I'm really interested in that. And I'm also just kind of interested in, how do kind of more formal ecclesiastical kind of institutions, what's your relationship?
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah, great question. So let's see, let me think about this in several ways. First, I mentioned before the Wild Church Network. So we're part of this sort of national, or actually US and Canada network of churches who are doing similar things. So that's one way in which we have connections. We have other connections with churches more kind of mostly Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine, and Eastern Massachusetts who are closer. So just colleagues, colleagues in communities. So that, and then we are, this is an interesting, you know, Eben, your question. I'm ordained in the Episcopal Church. We operate as though we're a part of the Episcopal Church, but legally and financially we're independent. So, but really we behave both on our end and on theirs. We behave as though we're a part of the Episcopal Church.
Fascinating.
An interesting, figuring out as we go.
Okay, so I wanted to, we've got just a couple of minutes left here and we're not gonna get to all the questions, I apologize, but I think we touched on most of the topics here. And so one theme that's coming up here are some questions about children, which I think is really fascinating. So there's two questions. One is there special programming for children in your church? This is coming from a kindergarten teacher and interested in children's programming. That's the first. The second one is probably the most difficult question of the evening. Father Steve, are there woods in heaven and snacks? And this is from Grace Bradley, who's 3 years old. So
good luck.
Good luck with that one. So
we'll get to that one next. So special programming for children. There is not special programming. Two reasons. We don't have that many little kids. But B, the way the service works, kids just do it. Kids enter into it so naturally. When we, when we bring, after our times walking in the woods, the silence, I invite people to bring tokens or treasures. For adults, usually it's a token, something that you find. For kids, it's a treasure. What did you find? And we bring back. So simply the finding and the bringing back of something. And then I didn't mention that we then share with one another our stories of what we found, what we thought, what we felt. And kids just jump into that. So they participate fully in the whole service. And they can get up and they can run around and they can do whatever they need to do according, you know, I sort of leave that up to parents. Come and go. Share what they found, because their delight becomes our delight. And kids, so very often when kids are there, they're the ones who open up and lead, especially that kind of bringing things in and sharing. And I think they just absorb what's going on otherwise, simply by their presence. There's it's really cool. We'll see what happens as we continue to grow, because it's still small, but so anyway, so that's that. And then the question, are there woods in heaven and snacks?
Yeah.
Well, I was talking with a couple of friends today and was reading the very end of the Bible, the book of Revelation, for those of you who may know it. And what it says is that at the very, 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 very end of the story, God comes to earth and lives with people, in the city, with a river and trees. So I think the clear answer to your question is yes, there are trees there and there's a river there. The difference is that we don't actually go to heaven. God comes to earth. And this is one of the greatest misconceptions of the way Christianity is practiced, is that according to the Bible, at least, the way it ends is that we're here and God comes to join us in the woods and along the river with people. So that's the way I prefer to think about it, is that heaven is actually here when God comes.
Wonderful. Thank you for that. I just took the chance to put the link to the Church of the Woods website there in the chat box, in case anyone would like to learn more. But thanks for sharing all of this with us, and thanks to everyone who joined for all these wonderful questions and wonderful kind of discussion that we were able to have as well here. So it's really wonderful. Anything you'd like to close with?
No, just thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your guidance, Eben. I'm grateful.
Yeah.
And please, all of you, whether however close you may be, if you're in northern New England or in Boston, we're not that far from Boston, hour and a half, come visit.
I mean, this just popped in my head. It must be difficult in the pandemic for you to hold in-person services. It's of course difficult to recreate the experience of being, but is something you tried to do virtually at all, or?
We have not tried to do it virtually, but we did, unlike most churches, we closed down a year ago for April and May and then opened up again in June, because we have not in the woods, but we have a larger open space where we could stand spread well apart and with masks. And so we opened up again and we've been going since last June.
Yeah, another probably unforeseen advantage of the
another advantage. We have also created something that we've called a circle of prayer that does meet by Zoom, but it doesn't attempt to recreate a regular service. And that meets Thursday evenings in 45 minutes.
Well, we'll probably let you go then. It was a real honor to have you. Thanks so much for this inspiring talk. Thanks to everyone who joined as well. And please take a look at the website there to learn more about Church of the Woods. So thanks so much.
Thank you. Thanks, all. Thanks, Eben.
Okay, thanks. Bye-bye. Good night, everyone. Bye-bye.